Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
What do you call a neighbor who begins to celebrate and mock when the house next door is on fire? Now, that description today could fit one section of the Chinese establishment, or in fact, there is no such thing as a section of the Chinese establishment. You might argue that all this establishment is the same. So this Cut the Clutter, this episode is provoked by something that's been happening in China, Chinese social media, and on official handles and party handles on Chinese social media, and a lot of Chinese debate. That is mocking of India, given India's ongoing COVID tragedy, and mocking in the most cruel and I would say uncouth and uncivilized manner. That is making fun of India's cremations, cremating of dead bodies in India. Now, the biggest spark came in, I'm sorry to use that expression spark, the biggest spark, and you will know why, because the context is such. That came up because Weibo, the Chinese social media site, that carried a post for Chinese Communist Party's Central Political and Legal Affairs Commission. Now, this is a very powerful body. This is a powerful body that controls all of China's law enforcement agencies, secret agencies, their security bureaus all over the world. So it was the most powerful. It was like the Home Ministry and Cabinet Secretariat in India, and a lot more combined, plus NIA, plus CBI, plus whatever. So the party organism or organization that controls all of the security machinery in China and all over the world is called CCP's, Chinese Communist Party's Central Political and Legal Affairs Commission. Now, they, on their Weibo handle, Weibo is a Chinese Twitter, you might say, they put out a post, and that post had two pictures, and you will see this on my screen. One picture is a Chinese rocket being launched. This is a Chinese rocket, which I am told, and if you read this article that I am sharing with you by Adil Brar, our new columnist who is a China domain specialist, please follow him. China is a very important country for us. It's important for us to understand what's going on. Adil is somebody who knows Chinese language, who's followed Chinese media for a long time. He started this wonderful column for us, Eye on China. Don't miss it. So I also got this idea of today's episode of Cut the Clutter from his column. So his column tells us that this rocket is the Tianhe, T-I-A-N-H-E, core module of China's new space station. On the other side is the picture of a funeral pyre burning in India. And the post says how the Chinese light a fire and how the Indians light a fire. Now, this is so uncivil, or this was so uncivil, I would say. I'm using past tense because it was then subsequently removed. It was deleted. It was considered so uncivil that even in China, in the party-run controlled China, a lot of people got upset on social media, and a lot of people said, this is not right. This is uncivil. This does not give a good impression of the Chinese, and we should not be doing this. A lot of people did this. At the same time, a lot of people came back to say, what is the big deal? Do the Indians really deserve any sympathy from us? And that led to other exchanges, which I will come to. But before that, quoting from Adil's column, let me tell you the other things that have been happening in China to make the point that this post was not some isolated indiscretion from somebody who was bored on this party organization's key party organization's Weibo handle, or somebody who might be particularly an Indophobe or an India hater, because there is something else going on there. On Weibo, Adil tells us they've been 139 million times over 7 days. The Indian epidemic has been a trend. 139 million times. Then he says, Indian epidemic in the month of April. It's been trending all through April. It has been viewed 1.86 billion times. So I know many of you keep writing to me to use lakhs and crores and Arabs rather than millions and billions. So I will use both. So that is 186 crores. That is population of India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. And you can throw in some more. That many people have watched that trend called India epidemic. So this looks like some kind of schadenfreude, some kind of enjoying your neighbor's misery. My neighbor's house is on fire, ha ha ha. See, I had the same fire in my house, but I put it out very quickly. My neighbor is so useless, they are not able to do it. Now this is, you have to be particularly nasty and particularly vicious to think like that, because India doesn't have cordial relations with Pakistan. If anything, with Pakistan, India has had an ongoing firefight now for decades now, with China at least, barring this one skirmish, for 40 years, India had peace, uneasy peace, but peace. But from Pakistan, and I read Pakistan's media, Pakistan's social media very carefully all the time, and I find almost no rejoicing at India's plight at this moment. In fact, there is a lot of sympathy, there are a lot of people offering help, a lot of people saying, I am praying for my Indian friends, I am praying for India. All right, there is some nasty stuff also, but those are trolls, or those are sort of ultra nationalist people who you find everywhere. But generally and definitely from the Pakistani establishment, nothing but sympathy and understanding. You might say it's fake, but it's there. On the other hand, we've seen from this very responsible Chinese handle is actually mocking of a kind that you don't expect from a modern, progressing, powerful nation with a strong establishment. But this happened. Maybe it was just a slip up, but it did happen. 30th April, Chinese Public Security Administration, this is again from Adil's column, 30th April, Chinese Public Security Administration also put out a post which had a picture, again a comparative post, a picture of the Chinese building fresh hospitals in quick time in Wuhan when the crisis was on there last year. Remember, they put up a big hospital maybe in a week or 3 days or 4 days or something at the Chinese pace of building a hospital. And they contrast that with a picture of a bunch of funerals in India, of a bunch of fires burning at a crematorium in India. Then another trend that has run on Chinese media over this past week is Indian vaccine maker companies, Indian vaccine maker CEO escapes to UK. It was the second top trend on Weibo with 73 million views, 7 crore, 30 lakh views. On Baidu, which is the Chinese equivalent of Google, this was the fifth top trend on May 2. Then there was a lot of other stuff on Chinese social media, because somebody said Chinese official media has been making a big deal of oxygen concentrators and other things coming from China, although all of those are purely commercial deals between Indian firms and Chinese firms. That is not Chinese aid or Chinese gifts, but the Chinese official media has been making a big deal of it, that we are helping India, which is fine because it is help to India, so nobody can complain. And India is buying it because India needs it, so thank you very much. It's better that it's being sold than somebody saying, no, you are not a friendly country. But at the same time, a lot of the people on social media in China, and this is something that we don't get to see, unlike from Pakistan or from other parts of the world, because most of it is in their language, not in English language. Somebody said, look, why? You want us to be kind to India? Why be kind to India? We sent 25,000 oxygen concentrators to India, and no thank you to us. Modi, on the other hand, is thanking the Western countries. So you see now a great deal of resentment, a great deal of anger, and a great deal of, I would say, contempt, almost bordering on the racist, coming out for India among the Chinese, among a lot of Chinese social media users. Now, social media users can be all kinds, but, and we would not have taken this so seriously if some of this had not burst on powerful, responsible Chinese official and party media handles, social media handles, because that gives you an insight into a thought process. Because another of these handles also use pictures, and many of these handles actually are doing it now, use pictures of the Chinese soldiers, the four that they accept had died in Galwan. So they've been using the pictures saying, see what the Indians did to us, why should we have sympathy for India? And there is a big celebration of what they see as the fact of Adar Poonawalla having quote unquote escaped to UK because they say India has a big vaccine shortage and there is so much pressure that this fellow has escaped to UK. Now, there is a pushback. There is a pushback within China or from some journalists as well. So, I have two more articles that I have used for this research. One is an article in Radio Free Asia. Now, you might have some questions about that. That should you, how seriously should you take it? But there is also article, also an article from Chris Buckley, who is a big old China veteran specialist in the New York Times. Now, these articles tell us, they quote a Chinese journalist, a woman, Gao Yu, who's quite forthright and quite brave, I must say, who says that, look, when Wuhan happened, India sympathized with China. Now, the opposite is happening. She said when Wuhan happened, and this, she's been quoted as saying this, when Wuhan happened, China actually struck at all media coverage. In fact, it squashed all media coverage. Whereas India is a democracy, it is allowing all this media coverage. So she says that it's very unkind and it's so ironical that what India's free democracy makes available to the world to see is being exploited by a China which does not allow any democracy, any media freedoms for its own propaganda. So she underlines the irony of that. And she says, she's quoted as saying, India may be full of busy crematoria right now, but we know this precisely because of the freedom of the press they enjoy there. And she says, and because citizen journalists are allowed to report about it and post these pictures and tell the whole world about it. Then she goes on to say that truth telling, this is important truth telling, because this truth telling humanizes the tragedy. This also is a good humanitarian manifesto because it draws attention to a tragedy. It also draws attention to the need for better care. It also forces the authorities to take better care of the people instead of ignoring the tragedy or instead of being callous about it. So she's pointing out to you the strength of an open democracy like India, which allows this coverage to take place. And she says, she doesn't say what a shame, I'm saying that. What a shame or what an irony that China actually is misusing that freedom for its own propaganda. Now, if you go back to what happened in China and how the Chinese happened with their own media when Wuhan happened. So at that point of time, several journalists were jailed. China is the biggest jailer of journalists in the world. At this point, more than 100 journalists and bloggers are jailed in China. Many of them formally, but many of them also informally. In fact, three of the most voluble bloggers, citizen journalists, when Wuhan was unfolding, have disappeared. It's presumed they are in the Chinese government custody, but we don't even know where they are. Some others were jailed. Zhang Zhan, the famous case, she was jailed on last December 28 for 4 years for spreading rumors, for asking for trouble, for creating trouble, stuff like that, giving China a bad name. So you jail your own journalists for even putting out some facts about you, and then you pick up facts from an open democracy and you try and shame it, and you try to give your own people cheap satisfaction or cheap source of enjoying your neighbor's plight. What kind of countries and what kind of establishments do it? So once again, I'm inclined to go back to the expression that Pompeo used all the time. He said, make a distinction between the Chinese people and the country of China and the CCP. I would not have said it if this stuff had not gone out from a very powerful CCP handle. This is what has happened right now. So this surprisingly has also got a pushback from Hu Shijin, who is a well-known familiar byline in India. He's the editor-in-chief of Global Times, which usually mocks India in other ways, but not on this tragedy. And Hu Shijin has said that by doing this, you are actually destroying China's goodwill in India. You should not do this. And once again, it's not as if everybody agrees with him either in China. So Radio Free Asia quotes Shen Yi, a Shanghai academic, who describes him, who dismisses people who are now feeling embarrassed about this Chinese mocking of India as pearl clutchers. Now, I don't exactly know what that means. It's obviously some kind of an insult to say you are lazy or you are soft or you are spineless or whatever. Maybe one of our viewers will throw some light on this and I'll be grateful. And goes on to say, how can you sympathize with India? You can have no sympathies with India. And then this caller says about China, that why be apologetic about your own power? And this caller says, where can an 800-pound gorilla sleep? Wherever it wants. So might is right. You have the power. You want to mock a weaker neighbor, you mock them. Then there is a record of this happening in China. The French had summoned the Chinese ambassador last year when Chinese media, again at the same level, combination of social media and Chinese official media, they had spread the news or the canard that in France, nurses were abandoning nursing homes and leaving patients to their own fate because they were so afraid of COVID. Similarly, in Australia, the Australian Prime Minister himself had protested when the Chinese put out that picture, that terrible picture, morph picture of an Australian soldier in Afghanistan holding a knife to an small Afghan child's throat. Now, what is happening in China is, and that is what all these three articles tell us, and a lot of other reading, that in China, India is projected as an example, as a perfect example of a most perfectly flawed democratic system. Saying this is what is wrong with democracy and this is why our system, that is the Chinese system, is so much better. And this is where it comes handy for the Chinese Communist Party also. Again, if you read up more on China, you find that anybody who's been critical of the American response to coronavirus, particularly in Trump's times, Trevor Noah, the American presenter, very witty American presenter, is a big star in China because he's been making fun of America's handling of the COVID pandemic, particularly under Trump. The stuff he puts out is shared in China quite widely. And similarly, anything that happens in America, criticism from the American media of its own government is put out without thinking that a lot of people in China will also be wondering how come this kind of stuff comes out of America, this kind of stuff comes out of France, this kind of stuff comes out of India. But we don't get any of this about our own country. But who is to question a party-run nation or a party-owned nation? Because Chinese Communist Party is to China even more than what Pakistani army is to Pakistan. Now, please allow me to add one more note before I conclude. The debate's gone on in India over the last 3-4 days on how well has the media done to cover the pandemic and the government's obviously very flawed and faulty response to the second wave of the pandemic. And what is popularly said and gets a lot of brownie points and retweets and repeats and shabashis and wahwahs is that Indian media has completely failed. Indian media is now dying. This tells you that Indian media is even more dead than thousands of Indians from COVID. Now, is that the fact? That is a judgment call that you have to make, the viewers, listeners, not people like us, because we are on our own side. All that I would like to say is that people who jump to these conclusions and who paint all of Indian media as this dark space, totally compromised to the government, supine, down on its knees, a complete chamcha media. In fact, the example I like to use for complete sycophancy, chamchagiri, is a cruel one, but I will use it today. That is like a toilet mug. A toilet mug washes any bottom that occupies the seat. But that is not Indian media for you. For people to go around saying that Indian media is operating like this, they should watch the Chinese media. And I know that is not a comparison we need to make, because Indian media should be judged to the highest standards of media freedom. But people, nobody would have known, even the Chinese would not have known about India's tragedy in such graphic detail if Indian media was not putting it out. So painting all of the Indian media with that same stinky, muddy, dark brush is an act of great unkindness. It is self-flagellation. It's also self-serving, because it also suggests that, oh, I am the only one in Indian media who's virtuous. Everybody else is a toilet mug. That is not the story, because you have hundreds and hundreds of young reporters, many of them ours. I had listed out several last week, who are going from place to place across the country picking up the stories. We have a story today, for example, from Buxar in Bihar, that tells you that a place like Buxar, you will be surprised, has 6 ventilators. Surprise? Surprise. But no surprise that all 6 are not operational. Some are locked up, some are faulty, and in any case, there is no operator to use them, because ventilators require some expert to use them. All these stories are coming out. We have another story today from Shahjahanpur in Uttar Pradesh, a village of Pathan, ethnic Pathans, where 1% died of COVID, came from Delhi, died of COVID. Then 25 more died, but nobody's counted those 25. 2 young reporters have gone there, Bismita Askin and Urjita Bhardwaj, and they brought that story. These are Indian media. So people who paint all of Indian media with that same brush and say all of Indian media is one giant toilet mug, they are people who are watching too much TV, and frankly, honestly, even on TV, 4 or 5 wrong channels. So I would say, come out of your bunker, come out of your hole, open your eyes, take off your blinkers, and then see the reality of Indian media. Indian media, in fact, at this point, overall, by and large, is doing a stellar and brave job of covering this pandemic, bringing out the truth, and also reaching justice and help for people who otherwise would have been left out completely to their own devices.